Hey, this is Spencer Froh, and welcome to The Producer's Edge, created in partnership with Launch and, for this episode, LGND Filmworks. Today, we have a special show for you. In late 2017, myself and filmmaker Tolu Omoshore recorded the legendary Newark street artist, sculptor, poet, fashion designer, and sage, Jerry Gant, in conversation with renowned artist, photographer, and teacher Manuel Acevedo. Both having come up in Newark, New Jersey in the 70s and 80s, they talk about witnessing the rise of hip-hop and graffiti in NYC and how they impacted each other in developing their own unique Jersey styles. A year later, Jerry passed away suddenly, and this show was never released. So it is my pleasure to finally present
Life, Loves Us. The man himself, Jerry Gant.
In 1983, New York style hip hop had not made such a strong impact into the Jersey culture. You still had a lot of house music. You still had the roller skating ring. This was no Bloods, no Crips. The landscape was totally, you could watch Video Music Box. Redman, I don't think, had even come into being. The Artifacts, The Outsiders. Chino XL.
They were young.
So it was like the Graph Heads who was the one that was making the thumbprint. And I had a girlfriend at the time who lived on Isabella. And her and I was coming, walking from McDonald's or something, and I just so happened to cross over to South Orange Avenue. And I saw this guy who had on a leather jacket, and it had peace signs on it, and had, you know, the iconic Graph look to an outside. It may look like a motorcycle or attire, Hell's Angel, but when you got closer and he had his name, Prince, it was a denim jacket, and it was like a fist coming out. I don't know what was in it.
A dagger.
It was a dagger, and it was like well executed, because at the time, the J-Stars and the J-Rules and Seymour and East Orange, they were laying out like the nice, clean New York City Graph style, but yours was on textile. And it was like, oh shit, so this is him. And the first time I saw it, I'm like, oh, he's a far better painter than me. I can't fake jacks, because it was with precision.
The way we met is I started to see Jerry's tag everywhere, Jerry Nasty Naz. Nasty Naz 2, right?
Mm-hmm.
Two Nasty Naz everywhere. And with Two Nasty Naz, it was kind of a mystery, because the way I would see his tag on South Orange Avenue primarily, and then Jerry had something else that he had brought into the street culture. He was appropriating found objects and creating these installations in the middle of parking lots. And I remember he found this broken TV set, and it was, I don't know if he popped it open or it was just he found it broken, but he basically installed it in the middle of an empty parking lot. Remember in the 80s, we had a lot of empty properties. It was all condemned, especially going towards College Hospital.
Yes.
And I remember seeing this big monitor that he had spray painted in and around and kind of created this abstract object. He basically took this monitor and created this thing, which I never, it kind of gave it a second life, and started to draw on it and tag on it and created this thing in the middle of an empty lot. And another thing too, and I was trying to figure out who the hell tagged on my piece. Because Jerry, you put your name on my piece somewhere on the side.
Okay.
You probably don't remember.
I remember
somebody putting their name on it. And I was like, who's this guy? And then you, when we first met, you had this kind of like almost biker looking thing too. You were wearing a cap, some kind of like leather cap. And you had this kind of like layers of clothing.
Punk rock.
Yeah, that punk. You had that kind of like Lower East Side look.
Bingo.
It was like Newark Rebellion meets Lower East Side come in with some tagging and, you know, and a lot, an abstraction. You had a kind of an abstract sensibility.
Jerry is the seed and the dirt and the sun and the rain in this whole Newark art community. He fed so many of us. I can remember him putting on the Star Wars mask at Galleria Pharaoh, and all of my friends were there. Everybody that I knew and loved was in this room, and he had this mask on, and he was just talking to us about how dope we were. And we were drinking wine, it was an art show, you know, we were enjoying ourselves, but every so often we would just look at each other and just bust out laughing, crying, like laughing so hard because we fucked with what he said. You know, we felt it. It was a vibe, man. And he grew us. And he grew all of us at the same time with his words and with his energy and just how he wanted us to be. Like he saw us before we even saw ourselves. And that is something that I think all the artists in Newark that's like popping right now can actually say, that Jerry nourished that. He encouraged us to get popping. He encouraged us to do us and to leave our mark on the city. And that's what we're doing. So one love to you, Jerry.
I didn't even remember the year. I just remember the framework, which was on South Orange Avenue. Bowling Street Swimming Pool was the cultural hotbed of that summer. And it was all this talk going through the community of this Bowling Street mural, this Bowling Street mural.
So in 1983, I was approached by an organization from Montclair called Wet Paint.
And
Philip Danzig, who was the creator and organizer, it was a small organization, was into doing public murals and trying to get the community involved. Apparently he approached some people in the street to find out who was this Prince kid. So he approached me to do a commission mural at the Bowling Street Recreation Center, where I developed a couple of drawings. One, a series of Vailsburg drawings, because that's what they call that section of West Ward was called Vailsburg, and then we had the street name, which was Hooterville.
Yes.
We didn't go with the Hooterville. We ended up doing the Vailsburg piece, and in 1983, I did my first big commission. So once I did the Vailsburg piece, it kind of blew up. You know, everybody was excited about it. No one had seen anything like it. It was, I think the piece was kind of like 8 feet tall, something like that, by 60 feet long. So it was the biggest piece that I knew of at that time,
yes,
right?
Yes.
I got all that paint from my hardware store. We had money so we could buy the paint. I learned to paint myself. I didn't have any real teachers, but I figured that if I could draw, I could figure out can control.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And this was before I knew anything about fat caps or like manipulating the pressures or anything. I just kind of work with, Ace brand paints. Now you have all these wonderful companies that are producing really
low pressure Montanas.
Beautiful quality
paints
that last for 20 plus years outdoors.
But I also want to interject, the first time I did see his work was in Arts High, one of their school journals. I don't know if it was their yearbook, and it was a picture of an eye that was done in stipulation. And at the time, my cousin Chucky, he was always drawing the eye. But when I saw yours, and then it was these black and white drawings, and then it was like, this was pre-overhead projector. So your illustrative style always resonated with me. You know what I mean? Because I didn't have no formal school training. It was your skull coming from the soul. That was the first time I saw your hand style and technical aspect. So when I saw it a few years later, I saw the jacket. And we got to remember, this was pre-Facebook. There was no kind of social media. If you wanted to find out about someone, you either had to meet them or search through obscure little organic magazines or be introduced. And it was a few years later, so when I saw the jacket, then when I saw the Bowling Street piece, but then what really brought it to the fore, when I came and met your father and we went to your studio for the first time, and you the first one, and I've always heard of Jimi Hendrix, but you was playing the Star Spangled Banner. You was going through your Jimi Hendrix phase, you know what I mean? And he was the first artist who I saw. Now, I know the hippies had peace signs, but you was clean then. In the basement, used to practice. That was like your
coat.
That was your lab.
Yeah.
This is me practicing in my basement. I set up my camera. I was processing my own film. So I would set up my camera with a wide angle lens, which is 20 millimeter, which is 90 degrees wide, because my basement was really very shallow, my head would almost hit the ceiling. And basically this was my wall where I practiced. And I would just do these sequences of images as I did these letter pieces or practice works. So my wall was layered with tags, and anyone who came into my basement would tag it.
So you went from Prince to P-R-I-N-S, and then that S was always like a lightning bolt. It wasn't like the New York bubble or the Bronx. The P, I was like, that's a pure Jersey style. Now that we look back at it, you know, certain hand styles and every region has its space. And at the time, you was now getting into photography.
Yeah.
So you, by then, Too Sweet Hakeem is around now. You got a new generation of younger cats. But you was the first one that we all looked to, because now you started doing gallery shows.
Thanks to City Without Walls and Roberta at the time, who was the director, she was open to having people come in, and she would always look at work. Remember, it wasn't open door policy. We didn't have to worry about setting up appointments to go to the gallery. It was a community gallery, so they were willing to look at work. And fortunately, City Without Walls was also the first gallery that I know of to set up a really beautiful kind of comprehensive graffiti show where I brought in other writers as well.
I see the flyer right there off
the
wall.
Yeah,
this is off the wall. This was the first show that City Without Walls did. And they invited John Carlin, who was a curator, who was a well-known curator for doing, what did he do? He did this big comic book show at the Whitney. I don't know how they hooked up with him.
Mm-hmm.
But City Without Walls also published a catalog.
Yes.
You know, I don't have the catalog with me now. I have it somewhere in storage.
The Bible.
Yeah, so we have the catalog, but photographs of Henry. Yeah, Henry Chalfont was selling his photographs for $350. And now you can't, I don't know how much his photographs.
No,
I mean, I think his 30th anniversary book just came out a couple years ago, a gigantic volume. Frank Pelea, a local artist, did something with Crash.
Manuel.
Days, Zephyr, Rasta. They were in the show. I introduced, I brought in TC5, so I brought in Doc, Staff.
Yes.
Abby, Stan, I didn't do that, but Revenge was in it. Revenge is no longer with us.
Beam.
Horn was in it. Yeah, Beam.
C's, G.E. Wiz.
Seymour.
Yes, Vulcan?
Vulcan was in it, yeah. See, so this is the original, and this is what we were selling our works for.
He was doing the
Brooklyn dude. He was good. He had these interesting characters.
What did you do for that show?
At this one, I was playing with clocks.
Oh, okay.
I was playing with clocks that far.
Yeah, because that was your trade. That was kind of like a signature.
Bingo, the 12
right?
o'clock.
The 12 o'clock?
Yes, with the alarm clock, yeah. With the two in the middle.
Yeah, and two nasty nines with the clock.
Exactly, and so having that mechanic about time, because in New York, you had TV party, you had, you know, Say City.
Yeah.
Everyone was identifying. Futura had did the radio for the Clash.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So you pick an icon, and at this time, Keith Haring was just surfacing up, and it was like every idea I thought about, he would do it. So if I thought about a banana split, I go see one of his painting, it's a banana split. Now, if I'm thinking about Toxic and things like this, but what I didn't understand then is that was just kindred spirits that let me know that my ideas.
You were in the right place.
I was in the right place. Yeah. But at the time of hip hop and the competition and shit, if somebody do something first, you're like, he beat me to it.
Yeah.
I ain't messing with it.
Yeah, because we also respected the idea that there was no biting.
No, that's rule number one.
Yeah.
Explain biting. To the camera.
Okay, biting.
So they know.
Biting is when you appropriate something that's obvious from somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
Obvious style or styles from other people and incorporate it in your own work. And the worst thing about biting is when you don't acknowledge the fact that you might have been inspired by somebody, and instead of creating this kind of like rapport with the person who might have inspired you or give its original source so that you can then expand on it and take credit for it without any guilt, you would take it and claim it as yours.
Bingo.
When you knew it wasn't.
Bingo. And you academias, it's called plagiarism. To the street cats, it's biting. Okay?
That is so true.
Yeah, we're putting them all in. Yeah.
Yes, it's true.
Exactly.
It's true. And there was respect. You didn't do that. All of us learn from other sources. That's a given. And a lot of those sources, we kind of keep in our little black books. We had these little black books that we kept all our sketches in. That became kind of like our own little Bible, you know. We put all the information in there, and then those black books were then circulated sometimes to other artists. So if I was down with a crew, I would start a black book, and then I would give that to my crew members, and each artist would put their own piece. By the time I got that book back, I'd have like a collection of pieces or signatures or tags or styles that represented all of the individuals that had their hands in that book.
So then this was during the period of, you know, I would say my true Rude Boy era, mm-hmm. in which a lot of the times I was either, like even at that show, I was in the youth house, locked up for some young, rebellious, delinquent shit. So I missed that show, but I know at the time it changed lives.
Mm-hmm.
Then it was another show, once they moved into, they meaning City Without Walls, they moved into the Gateway Building.
Yeah.
And because I used to volunteer, that's when Roberta was there.
Yeah, and then I think once they moved there, Dahlia Dukas took over.
Dahlia, that's her name, Dahlia.
And I co-curated the Urban Context show.
Bingo.
I brought in the urban artists, whatever
yes.
that means, although we were all occupying the same space. But that was good too. And I actually have the original invitation for that here as well.
So see, this guy.
I try to keep everything.
Guy,
I lost some things along the way, but
that's
I try to keep
I love.
The materials.
Yes, because now
it's
could
relevant,
document
right? yeah.
the historical narrative and the art placement, placing us within a canon. You know what I mean? Because it hasn't been thoroughly documented.
Oh, here's the original for the second show. City Without Walls that I co-curated with Dahlia Dukas. This is the original invite. So I actually made the photograph of the wall, one of my practice outlines, and I put a piece of acetate on it, and then they just photographed it both back and front. So that's the original. This wall, I love it. You weren't in this one either?
I don't know.
No, I don't know what you were missing in action, dude.
was in a lot of places.
Yeah, he was. No, he was. He wasn't there.
He was.
He had a lot going
else.
On. That's what it was. Yeah, Jerry had a lot going on. He's one of the few people I do know was always busy.
Jersey was really interesting because, you know, our golden age came in the 80s. The golden age already happened in New York, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
You know, by the time it was the late 70s, they developed numerous styles and they were already getting play. And by the time it was 82, 83, even graphic publications were, print magazines were picking up on what was happening in this in street art.
And that's, hence, they had, New York has an industry. They got the publishing industry, they got fashion industry, the music industry. None of those industries exist over here, not to those magnitudes. So you had more people, exactly, the International AGA, exactly.
International Graffiti Times, 1984. This was the equivalent to a magazine. This was it. Before they were publishing pages, they were publishing newsletters. And the Source magazine started this way in a similar format, newsletters. So these newsletters kind of kept us informed. These were
our scrolls.
Yeah.
These were our Dead Sea Scrolls. And in order to get this, you had to go to this comic book shop called Soho Zat, which is on Prince Street in Canal. You couldn't go to the newsstand. There was like, now we got all of these shops where you can buy all these magazines. These things you had to go. Yes.
This was it. And this will kind of get me, it got me informed and made me think about the parallels between what was happening in Newark and New York too. We were all going through devastating times. I mean, you know, there was economic struggles, there were racial struggles, there were, you had the same kind of abandonment of cities. Yes. So images like this kind of reinforce some of the things I was thinking about and I was photographing at the time in Newark. In 1983, by the time I started my series, Newark People, which is now the Wards of Newark, I was already photographing and developed a style that I thought was a pretty good representation of what was happening in the city. Mm-hmm. And I was juggling that simultaneously with what I was doing with graffiti.
Definitely.
Right?
And like, while he was being informed by photography, I was being informed by reggae music, you know, so now I'm starting to shift into the performing arts aspect of it, and hence, you know, poetry.
He said, Jerry, I am ran with drag queens, dope fiends, hit slammers, baby mamas, cokeheads, walking deads, Jesus freaks, kidnappers, ass slappers, shoeshine hustlers, bra busters, jaw rapers, day rapers, car washers, jailhouse barbers, artists, thieves, dentists, therapists, and yes, only one Negro with bad breath. That was my man. And he taught me the ways of the street.
And the Baracas was already well established, you know what I mean?
Right.
So there was this other young youth cultural lane that was wide open, like Graff. And Graff was always, you know, a do-it-yourself shit.
It wasn't academic in a way that you didn't learn that anywhere except by practicing at home and kind of thinking about comic book images, car customizations, you know,
textiles,
things
of that nature.
Typography, you know, those are the things we looked at.
You got it. And so the 90s, now it became, how do we make movements into the industry? Now that decision has already started taking place. If you want to do this for real, here is what you're going to need to start considering. You need, if you're not going to work in the gallery system, you're not going to get in the gallery system, then you got to come proficient. You guys spoke about, this is DAP to the Newark Library of Stats, because those were our schools.
That was my school, yeah. The Stats in the Newark Library were the best resources I ever encountered.
Yes.
Because they had rare books.
Yes.
And they had lots of beautiful books that covered all art forms that you can just go to the stacks and just live in there. You can literally just go through the stacks, pick them out, bring them to the table, open them up, check them out, do whatever you want. And that was, I learned so much about contemporary modern art. That my first real exposure to even Ramel Z, that had a very rare, it was a catalog, one of his early shows that was published in a book. And so I think, too, it informed us a little more about what's just art in general. But then Jerry, I say between Jerry and someone like J-Star, mm-hmm. they were going into New York, different aspects. I think J-Star was more like a Manhattan Bronx kind of guy.
Yes.
You were doing Lower East Side. You two were kind of bringing in that information of what was happening in New York and informing us, too.
Mm-hmm. As well as yourself, because again, when you bring this out, and you mentioned the stacks in one of your artist talk, on the third floor, they had a plethora of magazines. And that's how I learned about the Bauhaus, Memphis furniture, the difference between the aperture and the Cochlin lens. So you had all of these sources of information. The difference between Helvetica and Lou Balton, because then that inspired me to go back to school, and I took a course at Essex County College, which was the MCA graphics, typography, and graphic design. Mm. And through that period is when I had all my little homies that I was running around with, just doing the nightlife, partying and things. It's funny how a new anchor was thrown at me, or a new life preserver. And then that's when I started getting into going to shows, understanding how to lay out Ruby Lift and Amber Lift, and learning the technicality of being able to now articulate what it is you're doing, as opposed to it's just fresh or dope. Mm-hmm. Now, what is this? Because I'm in different circles now.
A little art language. Yeah. Starting to adapt to the art language.
Yes, now you're starting to take trips to the typography museums. Now we're starting to go to ad designs conferences. You know what I mean? So again, all that organic evolvement. But one of the things I never wanted to leave my hand was my graph hand, my original stroke, my original, yeah, I always wanted that. And up to this day, when I look at people's work, I was doing a black and white drawing in my black book. This was about 3 years ago in Bryant Park. And this little French kid took one glance at it and already knew I was a graph head. But to me, you know, you don't see, because you so evolved and developed, and he looked right at it and I was like, oh, so you good. You see the DNA of this shit. That was like an aha moment.
The way that the plant is coming at, like, right from the corner of the eye, it almost looks like tears, you know? Decay has its own meaning, you know?
What?
It's unfortunate, but it's also, it says a whole nother truth. It's like this Buddhist thing, you know, where they would make mandalas and mm-hmm. out of sand and then just blow it away.
Yeah, because that's what I look at now, the beauty of corrosion. And nature taking its own course and creating its work within the work. Like collaborating.
Thank you.
hope you enjoyed today's show. This conversation will be concluded in the next episode, so follow The Producer's Edge on all our social media platforms so you don't miss out. I want to shout out the musician whose extraordinary jazz music is under me now and was playing in the background when Jerry was talking to Manuel. Find more of his music anywhere that you can buy or stream music online.